Hey, Robbie Miller, Tangible Parish President here at Hammond Square, where you can come shop, dine, and play, and have your pictures taken with Santa by Becky Blunt on Palace Drive. Merry Christmas from Hammond Square.
Lots of smiling faces here at the Ponchatoula Community Center, where the checks are actually being given out from the 1983 flood. But another smiling face is Representative Bill Wheat, now a senator-elect. Boy, this was a tremendous accomplishment for you.
Ken, it was a rewarding experience for me to go through the process and finally, after so many years, draw to conclusion and get to the point where, as you said, we're starting to get folks compensated for the 1983 flood settlement. And so, yeah, it's rewarding, Ken. I'll put it like that. Yeah.
Is this going to put to end the disbursement of funds, or will there be other events like this?
Yeah, no, we got Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday this week. And then there's going to be some other processes along the way. We've got some that are still having to work through some successions that checks will be coming later. And then we have a little issue with Medicare and Medicaid that we're working through. And all of that will be resolved, Ken, but we'll have other opportunities for people to get their checks as well. And so today is a pretty special day, though. Yeah.
You mentioned the reaction included lots of smiling faces in there. I can only imagine what a 40-year delay in paying off the 83 flood debt could mean to families.
Yeah. You know, I was just a youngster at the time. In 1983, I was home from my final year in vet school and visiting, and I got a call along with my dad about, I don't know, a little before daylight that morning from my grandmother about a mile down the road, and she said, y'all need to go check on your cows, which was about a mile down the road, and because the water's coming up. And Dad and I and Mom looked at each other and said, Grandma must be having a problem down there. She said, the water's coming up, which that was unheard of. And so Dad and I jumped in the truck. We headed that way, Ken, and we started seeing the effects of the water rising down North Thibodaux Road and how fast it came up. And by the time we got a mile down the road, in fact, the water was already over the cows. The cows were floating. We drifted them up to an old barn and got them up in the barn 40 years ago. And I remember it like it was yesterday, standing there. But it's been way too long. Those folks that endured all the things that they had to endure during that time should have been compensated a long time ago for that loss. Unfortunately, a lot of folks, and look, we do have smiles in here today, and I'm so happy for those individuals. Ken, the disappointing thing for me is we've got folks that can't walk in here today because they passed away. Carol K. Morris, Levi Robertson. I could go down the list of many names that were affected in such negative and devastating ways. Took a lot off their lives to rebuild the things that they had. And I want to make it clear here. What they're getting in here today, Ken, is not a gift. It's not a donation. It's not a reward. What they're getting is being compensated for an error that the state made in building Interstate 12. As a result of that error, not doing the backlog work, they flooded people out. It was not an act of God that these people that are coming to get checks were devastated by. It was actually an error that was made. And it was proven in court, in multiple series of court proceedings, that the state was indeed wrong in what they did. And it just, the judgment for them to say, yes, the state was wrong, happened a long time ago. What we're seeing now is that it took so long for people to actually be compensated.
Well, how about the fact that it's, I think, really been proven that the state is making the same mistake again as they six-lane I-12?
You know, it's unfortunate. You things tend to repeat itself. Well, let's back up even from that. The 1983 flood, where the floodplain from the Tangipahoa River was blocked off, never been corrected, Ken. We're still dealing with the same set of issues out there. And so, if you go down the interstate just a little bit further, in Dennis Springs there, you see a big concrete wall that's been built there. I'm concerned about that. And there was legislation and a lot of work that started last year to give some relief portals in that. And it's just a slow process. And you just stand back and you say it shouldn't be that way. And so, yes, absolutely. It doesn't make sense the way things happen sometimes. But we're doing our best to make sure people hear about it.
Well, not to look a gift horse in the mouth, but how were you able to get this done when so many lawmakers before you were not?
Ken, I will tell you, it was a combination of a lot of factors. In order for it to happen, we had to put together a coalition. Look, when I first got elected 4 years ago, I walked into the appropriations meeting of the committee that I served on, and I grabbed two attorneys and I pulled them on the back row and I said, tell me everything that you know about the 1983 flood settlement. And both of them looked at me and said, what are you talking about? I knew right then that I was starting from zero on where we had to go. Lots of conversations was had. We put together a group of people that wanted to hear more about what I was talking about. We had attorneys, we had the treasurer, we had the attorney general, we had a governor's administration that wanted to get this settled finally. We've had the Speaker of the House, the President of the Senate, and having conversations during that time was difficult. You know, we had to make sure they understood what we were talking about and educate them, let them know the importance of why we needed to get this done, and let them get past the egos. Baton Rouge is full of egos. And so some didn't want this person to win or that person to win, politics get involved with things. And so we had to fight through all of that. And so we had to tell people, look, this is not about you in this day and time. This is about people and what happened to them in 1983. And we did. We were successful. So one of the key ingredients is to put together a coalition. Of course, again, we had money to work with. That was big. That was huge. And so having those factors come together at a perfect time, groundwork was laid with other people before me that served in office that tried to get things done along the way. I think was important groundwork that was done as well. And so, look, it just took a lot of work and education all over again, and I'm just happy that we were able to put that together and make it happen for the folks.
Speaking of money, we just had an estimate that the surplus for the upcoming fiscal year will be over $300 million. The problem is the following year, a temporary sales tax will expire. That will leave a $400 million hole in state revenues. Remembering the budget cuts to Southeastern and all the rest, and everybody wants to cut taxes. I know that's the big thing now, but are you worried that we'll repeat the mistakes we did in the Jindal years?
Ken, absolutely. You know, I think part of our responsibility in Baton Rouge is to be prudent and looking toward the future. You know, we've lived in some pretty good times in the last few years with our budget situation, whether it be internally or whether federal dollars came into the state. We've been riding a pretty good high. You know, as we look toward the future, you're right. We have a pretty good year coming up where we got still some funds to work with. After that, the projections for revenue tend to look like it's going to be on the downside. And obviously, as we all want to do, we want to make sure our people are not overtaxed and that we're not taking too much from them to support government. And so that's an important part of it. But the balance there has to make sure that the necessities of how we treat people and the services that we provide are being done as well. So that's going to be our big challenge in this session and the next session coming up, is to make sure we get it right. We don't have those big dips of too low and too high, and try to make it equal out to where it's pretty close to meeting those needs without asking too much of the citizens. And that'll be our chore.
What else do you want to share with us?
Ken, you know, look, again, I'm just so happy to be standing here. I wish that I could escort some of the folks that I talked about in to get their check. Some of their ancestors are here and going in and being compensated. And look, you know, those individuals too were affected by the flood. Even though they weren't the primary plaintiff at the time, they were children in the household. And some of these folks that we're talking about had the disadvantage of the value of their properties out on the east side of town have been deteriorated, and so their inheritance was affected to a large extent. A lot of the folks that are here are folks that were farmers at one time, and their farmland was taken out of production as a result of the flooding that's not only happened in 83, but it's happened several times since then. And so, you know, it's just a good day, Ken. It's a good day for our community. It's a good day for the people who are experiencing this, and this is absolutely a good day for me. And I appreciate you all being here to help us bring that to everybody's attention.
Did the recent wind and hailstorms take you by surprise? This is Southeastern head football coach Frank Selfo. At Pride Roofing, they will visit your home and give you a free roofing inspection. Yes, that's right, a free roofing inspection. Pride Roofing is locally owned and operated and is the official roofer of Southeastern Athletics.